Good morning, everybody. How's it going? We were trying to think of a joke of like, I wanted to hand everyone something, but then drop it. Too soon? Is it too soon? Well, anyway, I'm glad you're at church this morning. You can experience the goodness and healing from God here. So why don't we all stand up? My name's Sean. Nice to meet you. Hope you have a good time here. We're going to open with a few songs, and then we'll have the rest of church. Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, rich in love. The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, rich in love. And the Lord is good to all. He has compassion on all that he has made. And as far as the east is from the west, that's how far he has removed our transgressions from us. As far as the east is from the west, that's how far he has removed transgressions from us. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord. And compassionate, slow to anger, rich in love. The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, and rich in love. And the Lord is good to all. He has all that he has made. And as far as the east is from the west, that's how far he has removed our transgressions from us. As far as the east is from the west, that's how far he has removed our transgressions from us. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord. Thank you. Jesus, we want to lay down everything that we're thinking about that isn't pointing us towards you, God. I pray that anything that's distracting us from fixing our eyes on you, Lord, that we'd be able to leave that behind right now and just spend time in your presence, surrounded by your peace and your love, Lord.
Jesus, I love you.
Father, you are heavenly. You are kindness and goodness without end. Jesus, you are royalty. You are honored, you're worthy of all our days. Spirit, you are a holy wind. Would you breathe and move and fall on us? Wonderful. Yes, you are. Yes, you are. You are great and wonderful. Yes, you are. Yes, you are. Father, you're holy. Jesus, you're worthy. Spirit, you're lovely. God, you're wonderful. Father, Jesus, we love you. Spirit, you're welcome. God, you're wonderful. Father, you are heavenly. You are kindness and goodness without. Yes, you are. Yes, you are. You are great and wonderful. Yes, you are. Yes, you are. Father in heaven, Jesus. Spirit within us, God, you're wonderful. God, you're our Father. Jesus, our brother. Spirit, God, you're wonderful. Father, you are heavenly. You are kindness and goodness without end. Jesus, you are royalty. You are honored, you're worthy of all our days. Spirit, you are a holy. Yes, you are. Yes, you are. Worship you this morning, Lord, and we adore you. We say that you are great and wonderful and worthy of every bit of praise that we can muster up for you. Amen. Well, hey, again, welcome to the church. It's great to see everybody. Why don't you grab a seat, say howdy to someone next to you if you'd like. And here's Tina.
Thanks, John. Good morning, church. Good morning, Pete. Good morning, Pastor Donnell. Good morning, everyone. Oh, look, I can see you now. You all look fantastic. How's everyone enjoying the cold weather? Did you see snow yesterday? Yeah. Yeah, I was excited. That means scarves, gloves, vests. It's time. It's very good. Well, welcome. My name is Tina Berry, and I'm here to tell you a little bit about the church, about what we have coming up in the next couple of days and weeks. Today, even, in fact. So get ready. Everything I have to say, I have handouts like Vanna, but the best resource for all the extra details are going to be this bulletin, which the lovely Miss Susan Long probably gave you as you came in. Isn't she great? Where are you, Susan? Or this fantastic welcome brochure here. So feel free to read along. Like, this is one of those, like, you know those books that used to have the tape that came with them, and it would, like, make a little sound for you to, like, turn the page and get all of the rest of the, just pretend that's happening. That's maybe only a millennial thing. Okay, so a couple things you might find helpful. So we're going to start with our welcome booklet here. You can find it at the welcome station, which is right up at the front entrance. It's kind of like a green semicircle when you come on in. Inside this, it's got some information about our church and who we are, some contact information. It's a great way to be like, so what's the Vineyard about and how do I make the next step? But a key piece is this sort of tear off here. That is my daughter. I love you, Cora. We had bets on how long it would take before that happened. Real sorry, everybody. So, this guest info card, if you're wondering, what is this place? How can I get connected? And how can my toddler make a scene when I'm up on stage? Then this is the card that you would fill out. If you're thinking, I want to do that right now, but I don't have a welcome brochure, that's okay too. That's what these are for in the seat backs in front of you. So there are three. There's a welcome card, and on here, if you put down some of your information about you, you can either put it in the offering bag when it comes around, or you can take it to a person at that welcome desk, and they will give you a wonderful Starbucks gift card. I availed myself of the Starbucks this morning. It was delightful. So if you feel like you would like to have that happen, here's your ticket to that. Or we'll send you a CD or MP3 of some wonderful worship music. The next card is the giving card. It tells a little bit about how you can contribute to help make all the wonderful things we do here at Vineyard continue to happen. There's offering bags in the traditional way, but there's also a giving kiosk, or you can give online. And Sean will tell you a little bit more about that when it's that time in the celebration. And the last card is the prayer card. So each week, our wonderful staff here at the church take time to lift up your thanksgivings and prayers. And so this is a way to write it down, put it in the offering bag when it comes around, and we'll get a way to know what's on your heart. So you can fill that out now. I'm not offended, or anytime during the sermon. Donna will be so pleased to watch you take notes. He's nodding enthusiastically. He wants you to write during the sermon. So now I'm going to tell you a little bit about just three upcoming events. So there are many, which is why it would be time to look at this wonderful item, your bulletin, for more details about the rest of what I'm going to tell you about today and what's some other things we don't have time to talk about. First is Slice of Life. So this is a fun way of us learning about each other and making connections. You know that thing when you meet somebody at church and you're like, oh my goodness, I totally didn't know that you were also a graphic designer or whatever it is, and you think, wouldn't it be fantastic if we could hang out and talk about that? Well, look at this. For some groups of people, we're like starting to help you foster those connections already. So today, we will be talking about people who have an international background. So I'll be telling you a little bit more about that in a minute. But this is an opportunity for you to hear just a little bit about somebody's story and then follow up with them after the celebration to enjoy a slice of pizza. See how the wordplay happened there. And further that conversation, make some connections, and just enjoy your afternoon. So I will introduce that at the end here. Next is Fall Festival coming up. I'm so excited. I love Fall Festival. So we need one of the key components of the Fall Festival, the thing that all the children secretly are coming for, the candy. That's right. So we need big bags. Like, the little bags are welcome if you bring like 10. No, I'm just kidding. Big bags, small bags, but definitely big bags of good candy. Bring them on in. There's like a bin out in the entryway for those, or you can write a check and just write Fall Festival in the memo line, and we bought candy for you and make it real simple. So whatever works for you, bring that in, and that would be great. That helps make Fall Festival a success. We also need volunteers to help move chairs and decorate on Friday, October 30th from 5 to 7. So if you would like to do some of that more practical help, making this place into a Fall Festival wonderland, then do that on the 30th. And then Fall Festival is on the 31st. Coffee hour. If you have questions about the church, or you want to connect more with the pastoral staff, or you just want to, you know, Nigel says, prolong your trip out of the blistering Michigan winter. Oh, Nigel. Then that's today after church. So, January 20th. January 25th? Really? It's today, right? Yes, it's today. It's today. After church, it's today. For coffee hour, some tea, coffee, light snacks, chance to talk one-on-one. Today, we're also, our friend Mary is here to sell ground cover news out in the lobby. It's designed as a way to help people go from homeless to housed and from jobless to employed. It's only $1. So stop by and chat with Mary. She's a delight. And pick up your copy. If you are in 5th to 8th grade, you know what to do. Head on out this way. And we have a couple places to go if you have a vocal child, because some of us do have vocal children. We have a cry room, which is here to my right for moms. And out in the gallery with the wood floor where the coffee is, you can see and hear the whole celebration. Please turn your cell phones and pagers to silent and welcome Elaine Harris, who will share more with us today about our Slice of Life Hangout. Thanks, Elaine.
Today we continue two community life initiatives, the first being Slice of Life. Since our community is made up of many people from different backgrounds or different places in their lives, during each service we will have one person share their slice of life. If you feel you share a similar story with this person, you're invited to come to the cafe immediately after the service to connect with them and others with similar stories over a slice of pizza. Each week we'll have a new theme. Last week was academia. Next week will be the helping professions. The second initiative, as we make an effort to learn more about one another, is to learn one another's names. To facilitate this, we will take a moment here to distribute name tags, so please pass them around and write your name. We serve a God that knows us by name, and we want to be a community where we know each other by name. A lot of you are wearing them already. That's good. Well, this week it's me sharing my slice of life from an international perspective. As you can tell, I'm not American. I'm British, English in fact, and sadly, I don't watch Doctor Who. That's normally the second question I get asked. Or, yeah, maybe English and American accent, Australian accents do sound similar, but I'm not Australian. It was exactly a year ago that I arrived in Ann Arbor from England. I'd never been here before, but my husband had for work, and it was raining as we drove from Detroit Airport, and this made me feel at home. We were embarking on a 2-year adventure that had brought us here from my husband's job. We'd come with our two boys, Alex and Zachary, and in April this year, we welcomed Jude, who was born here at the University Hospital. This time has been challenging as we have adjusted to a different environment, navigated new experiences, and met so many wonderful new friends. However, at times we have felt homesick, missing family and friends back home, and anxious in a sea of new challenges. Learning to drive an automatic and on the wrong side of the road was indeed a challenge. I only tried to go round and roundabout the wrong way twice. But at least you have roundabouts. That made me feel at home too. As was finding somewhere for Alex to start school and just trying to figure out a whole new schooling system. However, I feel that God has smoothed the way for these transitions and brought us together as a family unit. I was just thinking about some ideas of the challenges that people from overseas may have. So this is one of these, you know your international when. You can look at a clock and know what time it is in your home country and whether it's an appropriate time to Skype your parents. You know you're international when you have change in your purse from your home country that always gets in the way when you're trying to pay for something. You have to adjust the paper size on your printer. And you have a mental block every time someone asks you yours or one of your children's birthdays as you have to rearrange the day and the month. I didn't really forget. When you don't know if the price you're paying for something is good, until you stood there for 5 minutes trying to work out how much you would pay for it in your home country. And when you have to translate lots of what you say. Okay, I speak English, but I get told off by my 5-year-old for not speaking American. He says, no one will understand you, but I'm sorry, a diaper will always be a nappy, a stroller, a pushchair, a trash can, a bin, and a parking lot, a car park. However, I can truly say we have had our time here so far made so much easier and so enjoyable by the wonderful people we've met and the friends we've made. This church body has welcomed us with open arms and made space for us and taken time to get to know us and include us. Thank you. If you consider yourself to be international, then please join myself and Stephen, my husband, in the cafe after the service, and we'd love to hear your story. Thank you.
Thanks, Emily. I actually think a car park for a parking lot actually makes more sense, right? You go and it's like all these cars, they're parked there, and so it's like a park for cars. All right, good morning and welcome to the Vineyard. I'm Pastor Donnell. Hey, if you didn't get a do so now, and if you're the kind of person who doesn't like to get up in the middle of the service, would you get one for the people in your row? Because some of you don't mind getting up. They're right behind Nick. Can you put your hand up with that Michigan State sweatshirt on? And I know some of us are still in pain from, I don't even like football, as you all know. I especially don't like the Michigan fans that park in front of my house, but that game last night was just absolutely devastating. So my kids and I watched it together, and I don't know, I can understand why some of you are grieving this morning and maybe in tears because of what happened. One thing I did want to note, the guy who fumbled the kickoff, he got like a bunch of death threats and harassment online. So when we get to the end of the sermon, let's just say a prayer for him, you know, just to let him know that he's loved by a community of folks who care. So good morning and welcome. I'm so glad that you're here with us this morning. If this is your first time or your 100th time, I'm glad that you're here in our community today. Whether you arrived here this morning because of an internet search, or you're here this morning because you were invited, or you're here because you already knew the way, we are grateful that you are here with us this morning. You know, we have a simple prayer for you in our space this morning, and it just involves three things. We want that you would experience welcome, that you would experience acceptance, and that you would find space to have an encounter with the loving presence of the living God. That's what we want for you this morning. Amen? Last week, we considered the impact of Jesus' words found in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 5, starting in verse 17. We're making our way through the Sermon on the Mount. We're not going to go through the whole Sermon on the Mount. I'm not going to go verse by verse. I want to do that later. I'm really excited to do that in the future. I don't know when in the future. But specifically, what we did last week is we focused in on verse 20, where Jesus instructs us that unless our righteousness exceeds that of the Pharisees, he says, we will not enter the kingdom of God. Now, we wrestled a bit last week with, what's the good news in this? When Jesus says that unless your righteousness exceeds that of the Pharisees, something that those who were hearing it believed was impossible, maybe he was hinting at something. Maybe he was trying to say something to us. Maybe he was inviting us to learn how to be dependent on a God who cares for us and who provides for us. You know, the announcement of good news in the Beatitudes, the verses, the 15 or so verses that precede this section, they were not intended to become conditions that we should aspire to. Rather, they were an acknowledgement of how God sees us as we are. So Jesus turns to an expert in dependency, and he gives us these words, which are found in Luke chapter 18, verse 17. I tell you the truth, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a child will never enter it. We get into the kingdom with our hands open. It's a posture that we have to be in because we have to let go of everything that we believe qualifies us as well as everything that we believe disqualifies us. And throughout this sermon series, I've tried to highlight what I think Jesus is really challenging us with, which is, you know, follow me as I lead you into life. And over, we see that Jesus accepts us as we are, but he doesn't leave us where we are. He doesn't leave us where he finds us. Instead, what he does is he invites us to trust him and to follow him through the narrow gate into life, into the kingdom of God. Now, all of this comes into sharper focus as we shift a little bit in the Sermon on the Mount, starting in verse 21. Here, we see the shift from the announcement of good news, as it were, to what seems like a set of commands. And in fact, there are six commands that we see here. And there's a tension, isn't there? We are blessed as we are, and to enter into life means we have to do something. We have to be something. And more than all of that, it costs us something. Reading in Matthew chapter 5, verse 21, Jesus says these words, "You have heard that it was said to the people long ago, 'You shall not murder,' and anyone who murders will be subject to the judgment." Verse 22, "But I tell you that anyone who is angry with a brother or sister will be subject to the judgment as well." Okay. Right off the bat, Jesus doesn't mess around. He goes straight for the jugular, doesn't he? He's saying to us, you want to have life? If so, then you don't just give up murder, this act. You give up anger as well. Now, from the opening verses of the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus is unpacking quite a bit. He's reminding us of the commandment to live as people who are becoming reconciled with each other. In one verse, Jesus orders, he structures, and he directs our daily lives. Do you want to have life, he asks? If so, don't just give up murder. Give up anger as well. Seems so simple, right? None of us are, you know, plotting our murderous activity. If you were, I'm glad that you're here at church this morning. We'd love to pray for you. You know, it's like none of us are sitting down with our little sketchbook of how we're going to lay out, you know, our snare to trap whatever person we want to trap, right? I mean, okay, it's like, all right, you know, I'm easy on the murder. Maybe the anger is the thing I have to wrestle with. Jesus is saying, learn to live in the tension of being frustrated, being disappointed, being upset, and being sad. Inhabit the tension between these feelings and your ability to trust a caring Father who sees you, who loves you, and who knows your name. But don't allow those feelings to direct your actions, Jesus says. Instead, bring those feelings as they are to God. All of this is a shorthand for saying you are the kind of people who trust that God will provide for you. But therein lies the tension. That's the hard part. You're the kind of people who value life just as the Creator God values life. Now, I've drawn to your attention those who have been in this audience over the last 4 weeks. And so those who were in the audience who happened to be Jewish, they knew that Jesus was invoking commandment 6 of the 10 commandments. He was invoking the law, that good guardian of the people of God that set them apart from everybody else. And as we read in Deuteronomy chapter 4, verses 5 and 8 last week, who is this wise and great and understanding people? What other nation is so great as to have their gods near them the way that the Lord our God is near to us whenever we pray to him? I mean, I think sometimes we just fail to realize what we're being invited into, which is this whole idea that we have an opportunity to be in relationship with a God who sees us, who knows us, and calls us by name. And that when we decide to ask him for help, there is the great possibility that he both hears and that he answers. What other nation could make that claim? Deuteronomy asks. And so Matthew chapter 5, verse 21, draws on commandment 6 of the 10 commandments. And what I want to do is I just want to unpack what I see here in this very first verse. And so I just invite you to watch this. Did you notice that Jesus used a rabbinical idiom? I didn't. It's okay. It's the phrase, "You have heard it said, but I tell you." This is something that rabbis would say to their students as they were teaching them, because they would exposit in exegete, which is just interpret, the law. And they would say, hey, here's how you have traditionally understood what this means, but I, your rabbi, I'm going to tell you what it actually means and how you should put it into practice. So those who were there listening to Jesus as he opens up, "You have heard it said to the people long ago, you shall not murder." They thought he was going to qualify it, give them some tools and resources for who you can murder. They were hoping he was going to say something like, "Unless you're justified, then murder away." Maybe he was going to say, "Unless the person's a hated enemy or that neighbor who blows his leaves into your yard after you've raked your yard, that neighbor, go ahead, you can kill them." How would Jesus interpret God's law? Inserting myself into the text and being one of the people who were in the audience, I believe that a few of them were more than a little surprised when he said, "But I tell you, anyone who is angry with a brother or sister is subject to the judgment," or is subject to the judgment. Six times he invokes this phrase through the scripture. In 26 verses, "You have heard that it was said, but I tell you." And each time that he invokes it, he seems to be getting at something deeper, something just below the surface, something for many of us is often a little out of reach. Scholars and theologians and seminarians, they see these six commandments as Jesus establishing his authority to interpret the law. And if I join them and enter into this traditional understanding of these six commandments using Matthew chapter 5, verse 20, where he says your righteousness must exceed that of the Pharisees, then I think they're absolutely right. Jesus is giving us six new commandments, and they're tougher than the originals. And yet somehow I'm still missing the good news in all of this. It feels like Jesus is saying something along the lines of, "You don't measure up, so try harder." But friends, most of the people who were in the audience already knew they didn't measure up. What was good about that? Remember, the good news that Jesus was announcing was this: blessed are the spiritual zeros, blessed are the spiritually bankrupt, blessed are the deprived, blessed are the deficient, blessed are the spiritual beggars, those without a wisp of religion, because the kingdom is yours. All y'all are welcomed in the kingdom. And because of that, it became for them good news. See, only the really, really religious people in the audience thought that they could measure up. Now, let me just pause and say, I know I have a tough sell here. There's one way of reading this that just makes sense. And when I engage my sermon readers, they go, "Why are you deviating from the way that this already makes sense?" And I go, "Because I love the scripture and I want to wrestle with it and this is fun." And then one of my readers wrote back and said, "This doesn't sound like fun to me." So I know I have a tough sell, but just bear with me. Either Jesus is saying, "You don't measure up, so try harder." Try harder. Do better. Live more righteous lives. Stop screwing up. Stop deliberately making the bad and wrong and empty and destructive decisions that you are making in your life every day. Or Jesus is saying, if you want to see God break into the world in which you live, if you want to see his kingdom break out in your midst, then act like it. Now you may say, wow, they sound very similar. But I think the motivation is what is different. See, if we want to live a life in the kingdom of God, then we have to live as subjects of a king. We have to live under his rule and his reign, which means it orders the way we live our lives. Doing this will change things in our lives, how we arrange our time, how we structure our time, how we structure the way we live our lives, how we structure and order the stuff that's in our lives and what we do with it, because it doesn't belong to us, it belongs to him, and we are its stewards. I don't think it's Jesus saying try harder. I think it's Jesus saying you belong to God, so act like it. Act like it. Let me give you another way in, because this is a hard word for some of us, and we thought it was going to be about murder, and you realize, hey, I'm not trying to murder anyone. Great sermon, Donnell. Yay! Right? But let's push in. Maybe Jesus was saying, have you seen an apple tree struggle and wrestle with producing apples? An apple tree that is well-tended, planted, watered, has the resources that it needs, is not conflicted about who it is. The apple tree doesn't get up in the morning and go, man, I feel like I'm a peach tree, but these apples just keep coming out, right? No, the apple tree produces apples if everything is working correctly. Or better yet, if you know who you are and you know who you belong to and you trust that this person is at work for your benefit, then there is something that you get, which is freedom to be who you are. So Jesus says in these opening verses on the Sermon on the Mount, since you already belong to God, you don't murder people. You don't even get angry with them. You aren't cheaters. You even share what you have with others. You don't just avoid breaking your promises, but you keep your word in all situations and you tell the truth even when it embarrasses you and costs you something. You don't commit adultery. You don't even lust after people that who are attractive to you. You keep your word. You give your time. You give your treasure. You give your talent away. And you love those who hate you. Yeah. Jesus is not messing around. He wants to shape and change us into the people of the King. And this requires something from us, doesn't it? Trust. That's what it requires. I actually underlined it. I think it's on your notes. If it's not, underline it on your notes. Trust. Trust that shapes our identity. Trust that makes us who we are supposed to be. We need to learn to trust a God who loves us and who cares for us and is willing to provide, or else we will take matters in our own hands. You know, there's this interesting thing that I've been wrestling with, which is in our culture, somehow we totally respect Jesus as a religious teacher, but we have completely marginalized and excluded him as an intellectual leader. We don't think of Jesus as an intellectual. We don't put him in the same fields of Aristotle and Socrates and Plato, right? We put him in another category and say he's this religious teacher. And this is a shame because dude is wicked smart. He is wicked smart. I'm going to tell you a story. And next week, I'm going to tell you an even more personal story, but this week, I'm just priming you as we sort of go through. You know, I've been wrestling with the outcome of being betrayed by a close friend. And I've been just processing this betrayal and counseling every week since about February. And my counselor has helped me to understand that this betrayal is not my fault. It's not my fault that this friend betrayed me or that my biological dad betrayed me as well. I'm also not the kind of person, because I've been betrayed, that attracts people who betray me, which was a really, really helpful thing to hear in counseling, because once you've been betrayed, you feel like a fool. You see all those signs, those warning signs, and you've acted on them, or you didn't act on them, or you were hesitant to act on them, and then when the betrayal becomes real, you're like, oh my God, I should have just trusted myself. And so you feel foolish, but the point of betrayal is that the betrayer was deceiving you, right? And then that was something I had to sort of realize, because you can have a lot of anger at your own self for not being aware of how you were being mistreated. And then my counselor helped me see this point a little more closely. My mentor joined him in separate meetings. They weren't together. That's not how that goes. And he said, Donnell, if you had the choice, would you rather be the kind of person who's trusting or the person who goes through life suspicious of everyone? And I've tried the suspicious of everyone. It really makes it hard to form relationships with other people. I mean, it really does. It's like everything they say, they're lying. Everything they do, they have an ulterior motive. Every kindness behind it is an ask. You know, every generosity means that you're now indebted to them. That, look, I can go all day on this. I know what this is like. This is how I have ordered and structured and planned my life. The king in my life was suspicion. Do you really love me? Do you really care for me? Or are you just saying that? So my counselor, my mentor said, well, what kind of person do you want to be? Someone who's willing to extend trust and be heard, or someone who goes through life not able to form meaningful connections and relationships? And I was like, oh, okay, fine. He kept going. He said, as you process this betrayal, I want you to fully process it. And I was like, really? Can't we just compartmentalize it? I'm a guy. I know how to put it in a box and close the box and walk away. And he's like, nope. I don't want you to apologize for it, I don't want you to minimize it, and I certainly don't want you to compartmentalize it. I want you to experience the full weight and impact and depth and emotional woundedness that you can in this betrayal. And I'll say, oh yay, great, wonderful, and I'm paying you for this, right? Like, this, I think I could spend this money in a much better way and be a lot happier. Right? Apple just laid out a whole new line of products. And if I just bought all those things, at least when I bought them, I would feel better. So to say that this has been really difficult is an understatement. It's also been very painful. It's been very, very painful. And I'm starting to realize that I'm upset. I'm starting to realize that I'm frustrated and that I'm disappointed. And then I had a new discovery recently, which is I'm mad. I'm really mad. You know, I remember a recent conversation that happened in July. I was with some friends, and I was unpacking the nature of my betrayal. And as I was unpacking this story, the friend who was listening to me said, Donnell, you sound really angry. And I was caught off guard by it. I didn't feel angry. I didn't look angry. I wasn't seething or foaming at the mouth. I hadn't even raised my voice above the conversation level that we were having in the restaurant. And yet, my friend could see and discover something that was hidden to me, my anger. Back in counseling, I shared the story with my counselor, and he gave me permission to be angry. He said, it's okay for you to be angry. And then he reminded me that as we move through the stages of grief, one of those stages is anger. And if we don't process and unpack our anger, acknowledge it, see it for what it is, name it, we will never heal. Jesus says, "You have heard that it was said to the people long ago, 'You shall not murder,' and anyone who murders will be subject to the judgment. But I tell you, anyone who is angry with a brother or sister will be subject to the judgment." Now, many of us exclude ourselves from Jesus' reach here. We falsely think that this first command doesn't apply to us. Murder? Eh. And then we say, anger, it's just an emotion. It can't be sinful to have a spontaneous emotional response to something that's outside of my control, we tell ourselves. And let me just let you know, you have a witness here. I agree with you. However, Jesus is getting at something deeper. Jesus is wanting to make us into kingdom people. So he's reminding us of who we are, and he's asking us to believe something about ourselves, which is this, that kingdom people try to live lives that are reconciled with each other. Let me just say that again. Kingdom people try to live lives that are reconciled with each other. Anger indulged disintegrates our shared humanity. And it doesn't, anger that is, it doesn't even have to be acted on to be a poison to us and to others. Therefore, Jesus prohibits it. Let's keep pushing in. Again, anyone who says to a brother or a sister, "Raca," is answerable to the Sanhedrin. And anyone who says, "You fool," will be in danger of hellfire. Okay, Jesus, help us out. What are you getting at here? Right? What led Cain to kill his brother Abel? No, it was his anger. But you respond, "I haven't killed anyone." You respond, "I haven't attempted to kill anyone." You retort, "I haven't even plotted to kill anyone." And yet Jesus is saying, pay attention to your anger. Now, many of us, it's not our murderous plots. It's not even the way we think about our anger. What it is a collection of small irritations, slights, and disappointments that build up into something larger. This is why in Matthew chapter 5, verse 25, Jesus says, "Keep short accounts." This is why Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, "Love keeps no record of wrongs," because if you have a record, oh, that's when your plotting starts. That's when your scheming starts. Because you can just refer to it. I was meeting with someone who was upset with me, and they were laying out their charges against me, and in the conversation, they referred to something in 2007, and I was like, "Good Lord, that was like 8 years ago. Like, are you still holding on to this? How do I apologize? Like, do you need some flesh? Get a skin pillar. I will skin some flesh for you so that we can move on." No, you laugh, but we do it. We hold on to it, and we keep accounts of it, because when the person does it again, we go, "Remember back in 2007 when you did the same thing?" And it's like, "No, because that was 8 years ago." And you're like, "I do, because I wrote it down, and I read it in my journal every night." And it's just like, come on. This is why Jesus says in Matthew chapter 5, verse 25, keep short accounts. Now, I've heard a lot of interpretations on this passage, and I'm going to give you my own this morning, and you'll have to wrestle. Raca, it's an Aramaic expression that sounds a lot like the sound you make as you collect spit in your mouth right before you spit in someone's face. I know. See, now we're getting close to what Jesus is getting at, because what he is pointing to and saying, be aware of your anger, is he's dealing with our contempt. See, as I continued to process my betrayal, I didn't find myself raging in anger. But contempt? Oh, yeah. I can totally get behind me some contempt. Understanding that Jesus was getting to the root cause of our anger, that is contempt, it was a simple invitation for me. Because as I processed my betrayal, I realized that I am, and in parentheses, I was, willing to completely and utterly dismiss my betrayer. It's as if they were dead to me. Are you with me? See, now I think we can enter into the passage with Jesus because most of us understand, or at least we're willing to acknowledge, that one of the things we have for people who irritate us is contempt. And what if Jesus' warning here is that it's right at this place of contempt that we cross the boundary marker? That's the problem. It's where we run into the issue. There's this thing I've been discovering as I spend more and more time in Scripture. Often we will see a boundary marker, do not murder, for instance. And we will just assume that the passage is about the boundary marker. I'm not willing to murder anyone. So we skip it and assume it doesn't apply to us because our issue is less than the boundary marker. See, that's how I have struggled and gone into this passage. You know, that circle that's around the boundary, that boundary marker, Jesus is saying it's about that and everything that's inside of it. I'm not interested in harming my friend. I just don't want anything to do with them. And as soon as I arrived at that conclusion, oh, Holy Spirit started working. Because conviction came. And then I discovered something else. Jesus is really brilliant. So what do? It's simple, but it's hard. We do what Jesus says. We check ourselves as kingdom people, remembering that as kingdom people, we try to live lives that are reconciled with each other. But let me give you an insight as I get you to the practical tip. The band can start to make their way back. Not all the way, just start. You know, they start moving. So what happens, thank you, Pete, if the person you're in conflict with doesn't realize that there's a conflict? Or what happens if they don't recognize that they've done anything wrong? You're the person with the problem. What is your responsibility in the conflict? Is Jesus saying, don't be angry with them, don't condemn the person, forget the wrong that they did to you, pretend as if it never happened? Let me give you some ways forward. Here's what you might consider. Think about what you are angry about. Think about who you're angry with. What was your expectation prior to the situation that resulted in your anger? Where did that expectation come from? Who disappointed you? The perpetrator? God? Yourself? See, remember that last line in the Beatitudes, the blesseds? What if the persecuted means just being taken advantage of? Or what if it means that the person who trusts God, that they trust that God will provide for them, is what he's getting at in that whole blessed are you. See, Jesus invites us to live within the tension of the kingdom. And I'm sorry to say, and in fact, I'm not really, but I've already said it, so I'll let it stand, which is being kingdom people is really hard. It's way easier for us to do something else. And in fact, that's what we choose to do. Here's my practical tip. Now the band can fully come back. Thank you, guys. I have a handout for you. It has three columns on it. On the left side has the passage that we're looking at this morning. And it's written out for you. And what I would invite you to do this week, which I invited you to do last week, I hope you did it. I think it would have been really helpful if you did. But I'll keep trying until you do, because I really want us to become the kind of people who believe in the King, who sees us, who loves us, and knows us by name. And what I want you to do this week is I'd love for you to just take the passage, rewrite the passage in your own words, and then ask the Lord what he's saying in the passage and note that in the last column. It's a really simple way of engaging Scripture for yourself and creating space for the King to speak life to you. So we're going to celebrate communion. Lindsay Ballerzer is going to come and lead us. Sean's going to continue to lead us in our act of worship with our giving. Before both of those things happen, there are two things I want to let you know about this morning. First of all, someone got me a really, really, really large donut for Pastor Appreciation Month. So thank you for that. October is Pastor Appreciation Month, and so they bought a donut that is bigger than my head. And so I'm not even kidding. And I will bring it out to coffee hour, so please come and help me eat it, because my kids would love to have it, but it's way too much donut for any one person to share. And I really do feel appreciated because I love glazed donuts, so thank you very much. All right, here are the two things. That was a bonus. First of all, we have Fall Festival. And in order to do Fall Festival, we need 37 people. You are the 37th, so you can just look around because it's one of you. We need 12 of you to help clean up after the event. We have everybody we need to set up the event. This is on October 31st after the event here in the building. We'll end at about 5 o'clock. We need you for about an hour to an hour and a half. If there's 12 of us, it'll probably take a half hour. If it's 6 of us, it'll probably take an hour. If it's 3 of us, I'm going to be very frustrated. So let's not even figure out what 3 would look like and get the 12 today. And then we need 25 people to help run the games and to help greet our guests and to make the church into an awesome place for kids. And here's my ask. There are two events that we do on an annual basis where we bring 500 people who are in our community into our church. Often these 500 people have no church connection whatsoever. So if you're the kind of person who believes that the gospel should impact and transform people's lives, well, guess what? We're bringing 500 people into our church where you get to help out and bless them by being a community that makes space for their kids to have an awesome time. And that's a sign of the kingdom. And so what I want is not to guilt you or manipulate you, though if you want me to, I can, into signing up. I want you to see this as an opportunity to bless those who would be blessed by our church just being a warm, hospitable, welcoming place for kids to have an awesome time on a Saturday afternoon. And we need 37 of you to do that. So after communion, you're going to come up and take communion. Behind Craig Lounsbury and Kathleen, put your hands in the air, thank you, is a white table. The sign-up sheet is in the sanctuary because this is important to us and we need to make sure that it happens. And so don't leave. After communion, roll on to the back and sign up. Get the invitation cards and invite the friends in your lives who have kids, because God does incredibly phenomenal things in very simple acts of kindness. Amen? All right. So do that. Prayer insights. I have quite a few, so I'm sorry. This will take a minute. The first one is, there are those of us who are struggling with anger. And the sign that you are struggling with anger is someone in the last month have said to you, you seem angry. The Lord wants to just give you an opportunity to give that anger over to him. There are some of us who are in this space and we've been betrayed by someone close to us, and we're struggling with how to make that relationship work and how to move forward in the relationship because we feel like the betrayal is too much of a barrier. God wants to dismantle that barrier. There are some of us who are in the room and we are struggling with forgiveness, both of ourselves, but more importantly, with the person who has harmed, wounded, or betrayed us. And this is especially important if it's a parent, and more than that, a parent who has died. Because you don't feel like you can move forward because you can't talk to them. The Lord wants to bring some light and healing in that. And then finally, and this is a little weird, and this is me, not the Lord, not that the other was definitely the Lord and not me. I'm in all of them. But there are those of us who are in physical pain this morning. And there are some of you who believe that God has just blessed and gifted you for praying for people who are in pain. And I just want to do something completely unorthodox and invite you, those who think, you know, I want to pray for someone who's in pain, and those of us who are in pain this morning, to just come and get healing, and let's see what the Lord will do. Amen? All right, Sean's going to do what I said he was going to do. Lindsay's going to do what I said she was going to do. And you all are going to do what I asked you to do, which is to sign up for Fall Festival. Amen? All right.
All right. So we're going to take our offering now. And this is the time, too, to get those cards that are in the seat back in front of you and fill those out, the welcome card and the giving card and the prayer request card. Especially if this happens to be your first time here, we'd love to get to know you. So get that welcome card filled out and drop it in the offering bag as it goes by. And we also like to pray for everyone. So if you drop those prayer requests in there, our staff will be praying for those this week. Now's the time to give money. You can put that in the offering bag too. If you want to put cash or checks in there, go ahead and do that. If you don't have that and would still like to give, we have a giving kiosk out in the lobby. Or you can go to our website, annarborvineyard.org, and click on the Give tab at the top of the homepage. Those bags are going around, so I'm just going to pray for the offering. No, it's fine. If you didn't have time to fill out those cards, there's some gray boxes over there on the wall and over on that side, and you can drop them in there, or you could give them to myself or Pastor Donnell. But let's pray for the offering. Lord, we're thankful for the gifts that you give to us. We want to not just say that, we want to show it right now, Lord, and give some of it back to you right now. I pray that you would help us to trust you more as we give with open hands and expectant hearts, God. We pray that these gifts would be used to let the hungry be fed, the lonely comforted, to bless those in need. We pray that you would be greatly trusted and praised as we give. We ask this in your name. Amen. Let's keep on taking that offering, and we'll sing the doxology together.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above you, heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Glad you could be with us this morning, and a special warm welcome to the newcomers. We'd like to let you know that our communion table is open to all, so please feel free to come down and join us as we celebrate the Lord's Supper together. Our communion meal comes served as a cup inside of a cup, with the fruit of the vine on the top cup and the bread on the bottom cup. If you require a gluten-free option, that's available on the right here. Be sure to ask for it. Let us stand for communion. Today's communion prayer is a prayer by Martin Luther King Jr. Thou eternal God, out of whose absolute power and infinite intelligence the whole universe has come into being, we humbly confess that we have not loved thee with our hearts, souls, and minds, and we have not loved our neighbors as Christ loved us. We have all too often lived by our own selfish and pure pulses rather than by the life of sacrificial love as revealed by Christ. We often give in order to receive. We love our friends and hate our enemies. We go the first mile, but not the second, not dare travel the second. We forgive, but dare not forget. And so as we look within ourselves, we are confronted with the fact that the history of our lives is a history of revolt against you. But thou, O God, have mercy upon us. Forgive us for what we could have not, for what we could have been but failed to be. Give us the intelligence to know your will. Give us the courage to do your will. Give us the devotion to love your will. In the name of Spirit of Jesus, we pray. And we come together at the Lord's table to receive this, your body broken for our redemption. We drink from the cup of salvation in celebration of our forgiveness, acceptance, and embrace by our loving Father. And we unite our voices as we pray together as our Lord taught us. Our Father in heaven, holy is your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. We'll come down to communion 2 rows down the center.
In our weakness we find peace. We trust your promise, deliverance has come. And even as we suffer pain, the Spirit's right beside to help us through the long. Wait for strength to come, hope to carry on. Way with you, Lord. Way with you, all our hearts are crying for redemption, redemption. All our hearts are crying for redemption, redemption. Sons and daughters ache for change. We look to be released alongside your creation. Feel your spirit deep within. Our broken bodies are crying out for answers. Leaving words behind, we long to see your eyes. Redemption, all our
We
do one more. Wait, did you guys remember to sign up for the Fall Festival? Oh, just checking. All right, here we go. In my wrestling, in my doubts, in my failures, you won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. Let's do that again. In my wrestling, in my wrestling, in my doubts, in my failures, you won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, my lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I'll follow you in love. My lighthouse, my lighthouse, I'll trust the promise, you will carry me safe to shore.
Himself, May every distraction lead you back to His grace. May thanks flow freely from your hearts. And may your lives overflow with His essence through this week and beyond. Amen.
I want to see this donut. Woo! Have a good week. Ha ha.